Okay, it is 7 o'clock, so I'm going to call the meeting to order. In our first order of business, I'd like to ask that everybody join me in Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So welcome. We'll start with introductions. I want to welcome all of you that are here this evening. We also have a student here from Holy Family School observing, and others as well. But first I'll introduce myself. I'm Lisa Whalen. I'm the mayor. To my left is Councilmember Patricia Thoele, Mark Vanderlinde, Pam Mortenson, Bob Christians, and on the end we have our city engineer with WSB, Paul Hornby, and then we have our city clerk, Kris Linquist, and then our Public Works Superintendent, Gary Peters. We also have, to my right, our City Administrator, Mike Barone, Brian Grimm, our Finance Director, David Abel, our Community Development Director, and with Kennedy and Graven, our attorney, Ron Batty, and not last but not least, our Chief of Police, Paul Falls. And again, welcome all of you that are here this evening as well as watching on YouTube. With that, approval of the agenda. Staff, any additions, changes? I have one addition that I'd like to add, and it would be a brief discussion. Let's put it under business items, and it would be number G under business items, and we'll have a brief discussion as to when to have a discussion regarding RFPs. So we won't necessarily have that discussion, but we'll get it on a future agenda. So with that, is there any other additions? If none, is there a motion to approve the agenda with that addition?
I'll make that motion.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, motion has been made by Ms. Mortenson and seconded by Ms. Thoele to approve the agenda with that addition. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes. Next, we have a special presentations, and we have this evening with us a school superintendent, Kevin Borg, with the Westonka School District. Welcome, Mr. Borg. It's a pleasure to have you with us again.
Well, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, too.
Members of the council, appreciate the invitation and the opportunity to be able to share a little bit about the district's long-range facility plans and some of the engagement that we're having with the community. And just to start, I was told I have about 10 minutes or so, and so I'm compressing over an hour presentation into 10 minutes, and so I'm gonna kind of give you a very high profile of this, but if you do have questions, please give me a phone call. If there's input that you'd like to give that doesn't fit into this meeting, know that still in this month of January, we're still gathering that feedback from the community. Okay. So again, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm gonna jump right into this, but I really appreciate working with your staff. I have to share with the city council that very outreaching to the school district and really appreciate their service to us and the community, and so thanks to all of you. As I mentioned, we have been conducting different engagements with the community around our facilities, and in October we had a community meeting where we really discussed what are some of the space constraints that we're hearing from community members with the Westonka Public Schools. And when we, and of course, I have to point. I'm not good enough.
Say it's try.
If we go to that next, that third slide, maybe I'll just speak. The six areas of constraint that we've heard most from constituents are as follows: parking at Grandview, the performing arts area or the theater, outdoor activity space, indoor activity space, early childhood space, and there's been question around our grade configuration, and by that, how we configure grades in the schools. So we have an 8-12. And that's really what a large part of that discussion is, the eighth grade being at the high school, should that be in a middle school? And so at this October school board meeting, or not school board, but community meeting, we took some time and talked about each one of these and had a session of feedback where people could give us input of how they see each of these areas of constraint, and if what we're hearing identifies with people or if they see it differently. And rather with the time limitations that I have, grade reconfiguration, parking at Grandview, outdoor activity space, I'm not going to take much time at this meeting to go into those, but really there's planning that's going on that you can find on our website. You probably read a little bit about it in the Laker. Just briefly, grade reconfiguration. We see the time to deal with that when we need to add classrooms because of enrollment growth. And when we do need to add classrooms, let's have some conversations of where should we be adding space to get the grade configuration that this community wants in our schools, and to do it at that time. Parking at Grandview, if you have been at Grandview Middle School, we have one rush hour, I believe, in our town, and it's really centered when we start school at Grandview Middle School. And so we work with the Orono City of getting their school resource officer there. We have the Minnetrista school resource officer helping out with our start time at the high school. But we just need additional parking space up there. And so we're looking into that. Early childhood space, with that, our school board was able to keep our levy flat this next year, but bring four-year-old preschool back to the school district. And why we're looking at that is, one, we right now have a wait list for students. People don't identify with our commercial site for early childhood space. Right now that's located at Stonegate Plaza, and they'd like it to be on the school site. And so the school board was able to, by using fund balance and also using levy dollars, we were able to bring four-year-old preschool back to the school district. And so that project's gonna begin next fall. It's gonna include about six classrooms, and we're really excited about starting step one. There's gonna be a step two to this, which is gonna bring all the Stonegate classrooms onto the school campus, but that would require a bond, and that's gonna have to be done later on. Right now we're monitoring discussion at the state level of what the governor and what our legislators are looking at for early childhood programming. And we do see that that is going to become more and more accessible to families, where we're going to have to plan for additional space. And so I'm going to try, here we go. Thank you. So outdoor activity space, when we look at this, due to the increase of students that are in activities, and also the number of students that are participating, we have a limitation of field space. And so you probably just read in the Laker, read it through our newsletter, Joel Dahl, our community ed director, and Jeff Peterson, our activities director, submitted a Hennepin County grant where we received $170,000, and we're going to be putting those dollars, our soccer club is engaging with us, the school district and community ed, to improve field two, which is at the top of the screen there. And so we're going to be able to enlarge that field, make it the size. We have an increase of students that enjoy lacrosse, so it's going to be large enough for lacrosse. It's going to include lights, which is going to allow additional use to be on this field, and really make it at a higher quality than what it exists. It'll have drainage and also irrigation. And so that's our next step. One thing that I would like the opportunity to engage with the city of Minnetrista and the city of Mound is, are there opportunities where we can use city green space for student activities? And before we look at buying additional property for this, is there some synergy that exists between our cities with some of their space, and how could that be used for youth activities? It may work, it may not work, but definitely that conversation should be had before we go and seek, do we need to purchase additional space? And so maybe something on a future collaboration that we can look at in the coming year of discussing space that exists in the city of Minnetrista and potential use that could play for the school kids. I talked a little bit about early childhood. I'm gonna move this along. Performing arts space. Some of the limitations that we right now have a 200-seat theater. But the issue with the theater isn't just the seats, it's that it doesn't have a backstage area, it doesn't have an orchestra pit. It doesn't have storage. So when you look at conducting a musical, for example, you're very limited in the cast that you can have in putting that on. And if you haven't attended one, I really encourage you to come to a Westonka musical play. You're going to really see the scenario play out there, but just really talented students. So due to the limited seating, which you're going to see some of the districts in our area, how different, this is the Wright County conference. We have 200 seats there at the bottom. It ranges from 800 seats. What this would allow is band concerts, choir concerts to be in that. There'd be community use if it's community plays or performances being brought into the community that we see the opportunity. And so we see this as something that we're hearing a lot from community members of, have you considered building a performing arts center? Part of our inquiry right now is with the community is that's something that you want or is it not? And the more and more we talk to people, the more they really see this as a value of bringing the performances out of the gym and out of the cafeteria, allowing us to have a better musical space, a better community space. What our step there was is to do a community survey. I'll get to that in just a minute. The second thing is indoor activity space, and this is more of a community recreational space. Due to the gym space that we have in our district, again, we have four courts that doesn't include the play space in both of our primary schools, but we have one full-size gym at the middle school, three full-size gyms at the high school. The limitation that this puts on is, again, community space. We offer Sunday night and we offer Wednesday nights for the community to use. They can use Shirley Hills from, I think it's 7 to 7:45 for aerobics. What we're looking at is by more gyms, you'd be able to make that more accessible to the community. And when we define indoor activity, we're talking about gym space. We're talking about a walk around elevated track for people to use during the day. Currently, wrestling is using an old classroom in our industrial tech area in the cafeteria. We also have our dance line in the cafeteria. This would allow them to get out of those spaces and to have actual gym space for their performances. And the reason why this has come up is in the 70s, year before Title IX, and so the increase in activities, both by students but also the interest by the community in the space, has really grown. And so that's why we're hearing the pressure. And you can see some of the numbers and how that looks with how that gym space is used. And so the space that we're looking at for this, if you go down our lower hallway, you would be past our gyms. It would be, that's the south side of the school. We look for parking to be where the loading dock is, and so people could use this during the day. So the community would be able to use this during the day, and they would be able to access on an upper level. And then on the lower level, the gyms would be there. Again, we did a survey here to try to gauge what the community's interest was. So just getting to those survey results, we use Morris Leatherman. Minnetrista in your past had done some surveying with Morris Leatherman, so you're familiar with how they go about surveying. Just looking at some of these slides are just telling you what the community thinks as far as our district and, for example, you'll see the tax. Do we use tax increase as a last resort? Does the school district increase property values? Do you feel that the school district's honest about spending? Do you feel that dollars are spent effectively? And when we compare these numbers with other metro districts, they would say that we're in the top quartile, so we're pleased with those results, always looking at trying to strive for 100% of value to our community. You see other slides of trust in the school board, the job of communication, the value and the investment of the schools. the improvement of the reputation of the school district, liking the trend of where we're seeing some of these numbers, that people are proud of the school district, like what we're seeing in these numbers, some nice increases that we're noticing. But going to the actual spaces, we found that 56, at the cost of what this would be, when you talk about indoor activity space, 56% would be in favor of an indoor activity space, 40% would be opposed to it, and 4% undecided. With the theater, 53-44. We also tested out early childhood. When we put all three together, the tax impact starts having an impact on people's view of it, and so it's negative would be 48 to positive being 46. And if you just put indoor activity and a performing arts, it's 49 in favor and 45 opposed. And so the goal of the survey was not just to talk to parents, not just talking anecdotally, but trying to get a wide demographic base of how does our community feel about these spaces. And so where our school board is currently is we're trying to make a decision of what really makes sense and what's the right time to deal with these space constraints. They're going to be taking this January 11th school board meeting and the January 25th school board meeting to really make a decision of, is the right decision to move forward with a bond and to bring this to the voters, or is it best to do further study and to analyze this further? Currently, I'd say the feedback has really been positive. Both from the survey and anecdotally, I think people see how our community compares to some of the other communities, and they also see the need that they personally feel and how they've used that space. But if people are opposed to these type of ideas or have questions about it, what we've been trying to encourage from our October meetings is really engaging with the public so we can hear, are we moving this forward in a way that they would like to see us move forward? So I really rushed this. There's no other way to say it to try to fit in the time that was available, and I could talk in a lot more detail, yet I know you have other things on your agenda. But I would open this up to any specific questions that you would have.
I just have a couple comments, and we're about to embark this year on our comp plan for 2030. And so this, your earlier comment about maybe collaborating on some things would fall right into place with that, because along with that comp plan, we are also considering doing a master plan for our campus here. And we have about 50 acres or so with which to work, and it has to facilitate our growth in the future, but also a park area. And that might be something that we could collaborate with the school on. So that's right in tune with what you had said earlier. But just real quick, you were saying early childhood. So the when you have pre-kindergartners coming and then they can't enroll because there's a waiting list, do they tend to go to other school districts then? I mean,
I think you see a mix. Some will go to either private centers, or some of them will enroll into other school districts.
Okay.
Personally, I think because of the commercial space, there's many that don't even put their name on our wait list.
Okay.
Because they don't identify with that commercial space as being a school site.
Okay.
We really think that this is going to be good for the school district of the continuation of education there on the school campus, a better transition for our students. But we also think that is going to be nice for the enrollment for the community and for our schools, that people are going to be attracted and wanting their kids to go to school there.
So they come and then they tend to stay throughout their school years versus going to a different school district, which we know can take a lot of money away from our school district.
But yeah, our retention rate of students that start in preschool is really high.
Okay. Those are all my questions. Any questions? Okay, well, thank you very much for taking your time out of your busy schedule. It's always nice to have a connection with the different organizations.
And please, if it doesn't fit in now and you have some comments, please give me a call, talk to board members, because we're really trying to put a package together that is at the right time, set up appropriately, that it can meet the needs here. So again, thanks for the opportunity to present.
Thank you, Mr. Borg.
Thank you.
So now we'll move on to persons to be heard. This is a time where citizens, excuse me, no, just a second. I'd like you to listen very carefully, please. This is a time where citizens can come and speak to the council. I ask that you please be respectful, and there's no verbal bashing or mudslinging of any of the council members. If you do so, I may stop you. You have 3 minutes, and when you come to the podium, would you please clearly state your name and address? We do need that for the record. We generally don't take action on any requests that are made. We can refer it to staff for a future council agenda. With that, I have Tom Donahue. Mr. Donahue, were you able to hear me clearly?
Yes.
Thank
you. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
Thank
Tom
you.
Tom Donahue, 6115 Sunnyfield Road. I was hoping Kevin Borg would stick around so we could address his buses that are getting smashed up on our roads. About 6 weeks ago or less, I stopped to see about getting our gravel roads graded, and I stopped at City Hall here, and I ran into Gary Peters, who was showing off his new backhoe that he wants to buy for $120,000, and I was chased out of here because I'm not allowed on city property. I live in this city for over 50 years. I pay his wages, and he lives in Waconia. Now, I don't know if I'm bashing him or not, I'm just stating facts. Now, the backhoe they want to buy is a Caterpillar, $120,000 from Ziegler. You just did a road project on Bayside, I believe, for $88,000. That adds up to $210,000. I've had Mark Melcher, I've been on 3 road committees, bid the roads in Minnetrista. Apple Garden was $60,000 with no Minnetrista involvement, no engineering. Mark Melcher's built more roads than WSB has ever seen. He would do a Sunnyfield for $120,000. That's $180,000. That's a lot less than the $210,000 you're going to spend for black, or you have spent for blacktop, and I hope you don't buy the backhoe. You don't need it because you don't use it. They don't use the road graders. Halstead's so bad you can't drive on it. Deer Creek's so bad you can't drive on it. Sunnyfield is terrible. And I asked Gary Peters to get them done before winter. Every other city around here, Watertown Township, Laketown Township, they're all graded, they're smooth. We've got the worst roads in the state. Now, I can't believe that after the third road committee, you've dropped all these request for getting the roads fixed properly. Now, I don't believe that having a road grader out there and taking care of the roads is a luxury, it's a necessity. If you're gonna have ambulances, fire trucks coming down these roads, they're gonna be all beat up. There's brand new school buses that Kevin Borg is talking about and owns, they're getting all beat up. They're coming by, they sound like a gravel truck hauling rocks. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we move on to Mr. Hosmer.
Thank you. Gary, I'm sorry.
Just for the record, don't forget to mention your address.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So I'm Steve Hosmer. I live at 1040 West Cove Lane, right next to a pond. Most of you already know that. So first of all, thank you for the time, effort, and expense you have all already applied to seeking the best solution for this drastically under-designed pond. We were all shocked in November. I saw it on people's faces when City Engineer Paul Hornby presented his memorandum quantifying the problem and his proposals with some possible solutions, and we were shocked because of the cost more than anything else. You then instructed the city engineer to come back with less complete and less effective solutions. Well, if you put yourself in the homeowner's shoes for a minute, then you can understand my initial concern when we talk about less effective and less complete solutions, particularly since there was an article at the end of the month, end of December, in Lakeshore Weekly that said that the storm trends are such that by 2050, the 100-year storm will be as frequent as the 10-year storm. So how can we, considering this, how can we even consider less effective solutions? So on December 1, I presented some alternate proposals, which I emailed to each of the council members and to Paul, and I believe to you as well, Mike, and I'm not sure who else. And I proposed some alternate solutions based upon an overflow solution, which would reduce the amount of digging out that the pond would require and hopefully would reduce the overall cost. Tonight I provided you with a map that shows you three different options for putting in those overflow solutions. The basic concept is, instead of trying to dig out the pond larger, which is hugely expensive, and it's a space that's already so compressed that it's very hard to do that, forget doing that. Just put in an overflow solution so that when the water gets to a certain level, it then overflows and exits to the lake. So tonight I've provided those additional details, and when the subject of the pond was not made part of the December meeting, it was suggested that it would be made part of this meeting tonight. And of course it's not. I know you guys have a lot you have to do. There's so much work to do in this town. So, but I am concerned that we're moving forward at a rate that will get us a solution chosen, hopefully by the end of February or March. I don't know what your expectation is on that. And I have heard from various people that you expected to be able to implement a solution in 2016. So I have two questions and then I'm done.
Okay, hurry up.
The time
okay, your time is up.
Okay, two questions. Do you expect to settle on a solution by the end of February? If not, when? And do you still plan to implement a solution this year? And if you can't answer that right now,
I don't
think
we can answer that right now, but
I understand.
We're still, and I just spoke with Mr. Hornby in our interim break and encouraged him and said you can use my name in vain if you want, but anyway, to talk with MCWD, the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District. So those talks are in the works, actually,
great.
And that is kind of, if you will, the hang-up. But we will have it on our agenda. I don't know for sure. We want some answers to some of these questions.
Of course.
And because of the holidays, of course, there were some delays. Okay. But rather than having it on the agenda and having nothing to say or whatever. So I do believe if you want to stick around till the end of the meeting, we're going to have an update on some of these issues, and that may be one of them.
Okay.
Otherwise, I can give you an update tomorrow if you wish.
Okay. But I know you're working hard on it, and I know it's a complex
and
issue.
it's not off of our plate, believe me.
Okay,
so,
thank you.
All right.
I leave those questions with you, and
yep.
Thank you very much for your time.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Osmer. Okay. I don't have anybody else signed up, so we'll move on. And we have next our consent agenda. And they consist of consent agenda A, approve the work session meeting minutes from December 7th, B, approve a regular meeting minutes from December 7th, and C is a resolution approving our claims, and D is a resolution number 2-16, approve a simple subdivision for Fred and Robin Green and Ann Christian to adjust the property line between 3440 and 3503 Kings Point Road. And then there's a resolution, it's number 4E, it's number 3-16, and approve a two-year extension for a lakeside setback variance for Fred and Robin Green on Kings Point Road. You'll remember we had that issue before us last year. And then F is adopt ordinance 434. This is repealing the city code section 1103.29 regarding charges for fire services. And then G is a resolution 04-16, adopt the reimbursement resolution regarding water treatment infrastructure projects, including water main, wells, and water tower. And then number H is a resolution number 05-16, adopt reimbursement resolution regarding items included in 2016 equipment certificates. All of these items were in your packet. Any questions? Any ones you want removed?
I have to make a comment, though, if I could, please.
Sure.
I unfortunately, and I apologize for this, I have a family commitment that I have to honor. So I'm going to have to leave at 8:30.
Okay.
So
all
I
right.
just wanted to make you
sure.
aware of that.
Okay. We'll try and get through as many items as we can.
Okay.
Thank you. Any items on the consent agenda that need to be removed for further discussion? Okay. Otherwise, is there a motion to approve items A through H?
So moved.
Is there a second? Okay, motion has been made by Ms. Mortenson and seconded by Mr. Vanderlinde. Do you approve consent agenda items A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H? Any further questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye. All those opposed, motion passes. Next, we have our public hearing for our Wellhead Protection Plan, Part 2.
Good
This was a lot of information in our packet. And very fun reading, I might add.
It'd be nice if we could just put a one-page executive summary for you, but I thought you should have the whole package. Mayor and members of the council, tonight we have to present the Wellhead Protection Plan is Annika Munsell from WSB and also Leslie Storley. And Annika is going to present the presentation tonight.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the council. Like Paul said, I'm going to do a very quick run through on the Wellhead Protection Plan Part 2. Here's a quick outline of what I'm going to talk about tonight, just kind of the background of the Wellhead Protection Plan program. Part 1 results, which were completed earlier. Part 2 scope, which is kind of what we're talking about tonight, and the plan of action. And then what do we need to do to close out the project, and then any remaining questions you may have. So quick background on the Wellhead Protection Plan program. It's mandated by Minnesota rules and it's enforced through the Department of Health. It consists of two parts. The part one, which was approved in May of 2014, it actually shows your area that needs to be protected for the drinking water supply management area. And it completes well and aquifer vulnerability assessment. And for Minnetrista, the Wellhead Protection Area is in Mound and Minnetrista, and it ranges from very low to moderate vulnerability. You are fairly lucky. Some communities have all the way up to very highly vulnerable, and it's entirely within Hennepin County. Part 2 was distributed to local government units on November 3rd, 2015 for a mandatory 60-day review and comment period. As of right now, we haven't heard any comments. And this is the plan of action for the protection of the drinking water management area. The Part 2 scope, it evaluates several data elements, including geology, existing land use, public utility services, groundwater quality and quantity, an inventory of potential contaminants, including land uses and wells and storage tanks, and it prepares the management portion of the plan with goals, plan of action, and plans to evaluate how the plan is working. So the Part 2 plan of action, the categories are well management, public education, data collection, water conservation, implementation, and evaluation. And then some example activities are newsletters, website links, educational brochures, and well maintenance. Many of these things your city staff are already doing, and we're just getting them credit for doing things that they already do. So the goals of the plan are to maintain or improve the current level of water quality, continue to supply sufficient water quantity, promote activities that protect the source water aquifer, and collect data to support future wellhead protection efforts. The comment period started November 3rd, 2015, and this is a public hearing, so if there are any comments. The next steps are the City Council accepts the plan to be submitted to the Department of Health, and then we'll submit the plan to the Department of Health for their final approval. They'll approve it, and then the city can begin implementation. It's evaluated every 2 years. This is a living document, so as more information becomes available and as things change, the document will change, and then it will be completely amended every 10 years. Do you have any questions?
How many LGUs was this sent to? That's local government units.
Yes, local government units.
Come to the microphone so we can hear you. On the tape, it doesn't come out clearly.
Sure. Madam Mayor, members of the council, to answer your question about how many local government units this was sent to, so basically we take that DWSMA, the Drinking Water Supply Management Area boundary, and we send it to all counties, cities, watershed units, soil water conservation districts that are within that area.
Okay.
So for Minnetrista, I think it was, the number of people would probably be between 10 and 15.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I was just wondering if it only consisted of cities and counties or watersheds. So yeah. Okay. Thank you. And another question. You said we have a low level of potential contaminants. So can you maybe explain why that is, or what what those potentials are?
Madam Mayor, members of the council, thanks for the question. That was actually covered in part one, but I can explain a little bit. It's the geology of your area. So you have a very thick layer of till, and till has a very low hydraulic conductivity. Basically, right. It takes water a really long time to get through this layer.
Right.
And so you have a very natural
barrier
way of preventing contamination to get down. So really, all you have are direct sources, which are wells.
Okay. And then we have a pretty thick layer too, I believe.
Yes. It's very
whereas thick. Other areas are very shallow. The layers are quite shallow before you hit the aquifers. So, okay. I just wanted to, it's just interesting. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? It was a very lengthy document to read, lots of information. But we do need to protect our aquifers that we use, that the city uses, and of course, residents that are not on city water use. So this will help protect those wells. Okay. Staff, any questions? Okay. Thank you very much. So this is a public hearing. So I will open it up for a public hearing at this time. So the public hearing is opened. Anybody that has any questions or comments is welcome to do so at this time. Anybody? Okay. Then I'm not seeing anybody dashing to the podium here. So I will close the public hearing and take it back to the council. With that, any further discussion on the council's part? Otherwise, is it later on, I believe, will be?
Yep,
I think it's later
succeed.
Under other business items. So at this time, we don't need to do anything regarding that. But so we'll move on to our business items. And we have approving our city meeting calendar for 2016. Mr. Barone?
Yep. I'd ask our city clerk, Ms. Linquist, if you want to come to the podium between the information that she put together that you see in your packet, and I'm trying to find the page number. Somebody tell me what the page number is.
I think it's like ones, I don't know, 189.
It'll be in the high ones because of the.
Yes.
It starts on page 48 with
one,
the discussion.
148, or no?
Approving city calendar, which is 6 and page 48 of the packet. That's where it starts. So I'll let Ms. Linquist go through, probably not month by month, but point out any unique or irregularities to the council calendar, and then hopefully have a motion to approve it.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, in reviewing this year's city calendar, as of before, past practices and previous council directives, regular meetings that fall on holidays or elections would usually be moved to the next business day, which we will also have that one in January here, since President's Day, Martin Luther King, President's.
February's Martin Luther
King. is on the 18th, so we'll be moving the meeting to the 19th. We'll also be doing that in February. Typically, the City Council will not have two meetings in July and in December due to the holidays of Independence Day and Christmas. So respectively, we will only have, I have put in there only scheduled one meeting day. The Planning Commission typically does not meet in December, so they are not on the calendar for December. The Park Commission, depending on what they have, those meetings will be canceled, but they are scheduled once a month. As in 2014, the city council chambers is used for elections, so the first meeting usually will fall on November 7th, but due to elections on November 8th, the council chambers is occupied, and the election results will need to be certified between the 3rd and 10th day after an election. So that's why we have suggested that the council be moved, the council meeting date be moved to November 14th instead of the 7th, and then still have the regularly scheduled meeting on the 21st. And as we've been doing in the past, work sessions will start at 5:30 on the same regular council meeting dates. I'm going through the months. There's basically just the July and December, along with in February, the meeting will be on the 16th instead of the 15th.
Right.
That's basically all.
One comment, we've already talked briefly during our work session that there would not be a Park Commission meeting in January, so we should probably take that off. And then the question is, since we typically don't have a second council meeting, nor do we have a Planning Commission meeting in December, wouldn't we also cancel the Park Commission meeting?
Madam Mayor, members of council, we on the calendar, we call out the Park Commission meetings and we just cancel them.
Okay.
So that, not knowing if land use applications are going to come in, we need to have the availability to be able to call a meeting if a land use application comes in. So they're all marked on the calendar.
Okay.
But if we don't have an item to talk about, we just as staff will cancel that meeting.
Okay.
It's easier to cancel the meeting than to add it back.
Okay. I just thought because there's no Planning Commission meeting, maybe there wouldn't be a Park Commission meeting. Okay. But we do know that we won't have a January meeting, so we might as well take that off. So, all right.
We could just cancel it as we normally do for the rest of the year.
I know, but if it's advertised or whatever, then I don't know. Whatever. Either way, but. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Otherwise, a motion to approve the city meeting calendar as presented for 2016.
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Motion has been made by Ms. Thoele and seconded by Ms. Mortenson to approve the city meeting calendar for 2016 as presented. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes. So next we have our approve our annual city council appointments and designations. Do you want to start on
that? I'll start, Mayor, but we'll have Ms. Linquist return to the podium here in a second to kind of, between her and you, Mayor, I think we can probably work our way through it. We've provided you with a description of each of the appointments and designations. We have them broken out as we've done, I think, the last couple of years now. Instead of having one long list of appointment and designations, we have a list of appointments and a list of designations. They're separate items. But we do have a descriptor that says what each one of them does, the date and time of the meeting if there is one, and what kind of representation that we need. Sometimes it's a city council member, sometimes it's a staff member, or sometimes it's a combination, and sometimes it could be somebody from the community. So we have all that description. I hope council members take a little bit of time to look at. Most are familiar with it. And so years past, staff has and worked with the mayor and put together what they thought would be good recommendations for each of these, and I'm really not of that belief. What we've provided with you into the packet is who the current member was in 2015, and then you all as a council can decide if you want to stay with that appointment, want to seek something different. You guys can horse trade this and decide who it is that you want to have represent the city, whether it's, like I said, the same or something different than in previous years. And so you'll notice that the 2015 designations or appointees are in red on the, this is on page 57. So that's where I would recommend that you start.
Okay. I'm gonna just make a couple suggestions because I think it worked fairly well last year with the appointments, except I have a question for you, Mr. Christians.
Yes.
So if you remain, which I'm fully on board with, if you remain the community...
Westonka Community Commerce.
Thank you, okay. Representative. I know that they have different events that also fall on the same night as the St. Bonnie Fire Advisory Board.
Yes.
And that kind of becomes a conflict. So I have a question. And I'm going to throw this out to Mr. Vanderlinde as well. What if Mr. Vanderlinde were the designee for the St. Bonnie Fire Department, and then you remained on as the Mound Fire Advisory? What do you think about that?
That is, you know, that's fine with me. I mean, and that's a good point. There are a number of events that take place for some reason on the same time. And our relationship with St. Bonnie and the St. Bonnie Fire Department is very, very good.
Right. Oh, I'm aware of
and,
that.
But
I wouldn't expect that it would change.
No, there wouldn't be. Actually, Mark would do a better job than I will at it anyway. But anyway, I don't have a problem with that at all.
Mark, are you open to that?
It's fine. I think Bob's probably a little better qualified, being that you're in that line of work. But so be it. If you feel that it would work better, that's fine with me.
Okay. Okay. And then, Bob, you can remain on or would remain on as the Westonka Community and Commerce representative.
I think one of the things is that the Mound Fire Department Advisory Board meetings are always during the day.
Generally right. 1 hour.
And the St. Bonnie is always at night. And
right.
That's when typically we have things like the Taste of Caucus,
right.
Of the Lakes, all those things.
Yeah. And in last year as well, you and I attended most of those meetings together. So I guess the only thing I would say is kind of just remain as is. Okay. The only other change that I would like to recommend, and think about this, last year we did a rotating basis on the Planning Commission between myself, Councilmember Thoele, and Mortenson. What I'd like to recommend, and for a number of reasons, I'd like to recommend both for the park and the planning that the entire council, including myself, do it on a rotating basis for parks and planning. It does a number of things. One, it familiarizes each council member and myself with the commissioners, both on planning and park, and what's kind of going on, and kind of getting a firsthand experience with that. Plus, it kind of spreads the meetings around a little bit more too. But I think parks, obviously, we're probably looking at anywhere from 4 to 8 a year, so that would be 2 meetings a year maximum. And planning, we're looking at probably 10 approximately, so that would be for each of us 2 meetings. So that would be on a yearly basis 4 meetings, and we can plan those meetings according to people's schedule. If you're going to be out of town, or if you have a busy season, like Mr. Vanderlinde, I know you're busy during the summer months, and other people can fill in for that time. So if we can do that, I think it would be advantageous for us as a council, as well as the Planning Commission and the Park Commission. And then it would also alleviate potentially having that joint meeting that we had last year. Some of the planning commissioners were not able to make it. Some of the park commissioners were not able to make it. So this would kind of alleviate that need.
I think it's a great idea.
That's fine.
I know the planning commission meetings that I attended were very beneficial. And it was really nice to sit and meet and work, see how the commissioners do work. And
right.
I found it very informative.
Yeah, I've enjoyed sitting in on the parks and the planning commission, so doing it on a rotating basis I'd be open to that. It would work well.
Okay.
And then that would provide some flexibility for all of us too, as Mayor said,
right.
If it's a busy season or
travel,
whatever situation might be. Yeah, we could back each other up if need be,
Mr. Vanderlinde, would that work for you?
Yeah. I'm not guarantee you that I'm spending a lot of time out of state these days, so I'll do what I can.
Okay, great.
Well, I missed this. When are these meetings typically held? Are they?
The Park Commission meets every second Tuesday at 7 p.m. So they always meet at night at 7 p.m. And they meet here. And then the Planning Commission meets the fourth Monday of every month. Now, the Park Commission is not meeting January. It's up in the air whether they're meeting February. We don't know yet. Most likely not. I do believe the Planning Commission is meeting in January.
Yep.
Yeah, they're meeting January. So Planning Commission, again, they have generally 10 to 11 meetings a year, 10 meetings a year. So, and we'll work around people's schedules. So if you're designated for a specific month and that doesn't work for you, we can juggle it around, yeah.
Okay.
So we're on board. So we'll just put the names of all of us on those two commissions on a rotating basis. And I can take, just if I can take the January meeting for the Planning Commission, and I'll be happy to take the Park Commission if it does occur in February. So that'll give you guys a little bit of wiggle room. Maybe, Mark, you want to take some winter months because maybe you're not as busy. I don't know. We can talk to staff and let them know what days or what months were less busy. And you don't have to do both in 1 month. You could do Park 1 month, Planning another month. So whatever works in your schedule.
And I can't do February, but I can take March for the Planning Commission.
Okay. I have not talked with Mr. Nickum, but I'm assuming we haven't heard yay or nay, but I'm assuming he would like to be reappointed. So he would be a representative to the LMCD. And Pioneer Sarah Creek Watershed, I'm the backup. If anybody wants to jump in and be the appointee, that's fine with me. Otherwise, we can continue looking for a resident. I have a couple people in mind I haven't been able to get a hold of, but and we'll see where we go with that this
so Mayor,
year.
Did you want to maybe start at the top? I mean, it was kind of hopscotch drawn a little bit on some of these things where we had some questions, but do you want to just kind of go in order?
Sure.
We're on page 57 and just kind of work our way down the list.
Okay. We have Acting Mayor, currently Patricia Thoele. I would stay the same. We are on board with that. Okay. We have the Economic Development Authority. Of course, that's all of us. We have the Personnel Committee. We have myself and Ms. Thoele and Mr. Barone. Generally, those meetings are during the day. We have the Planning Commission, so we decided on a rotating basis, all of us. We have the Park Commission. Again, we decided on a rotating basis, all of us. The Police Communications Committee, that is by contract. The appointees are the mayors and the administrator and then the chief. And then the Fire Advisory, St. Bonnie, we agreed on that. That would be Mr. Vanderlinde. And then the Fire Advisory for Mound would be Christians, Whalen, and Barone. The Northwest Hennepin League of Municipalities is generally the mayor, so I will stay there. The Lake Minnetonka Conservation District, Brett Nickum is our current representative, so I would assume he would continue in that capacity. The Minnehaha Creek Watershed District liaison, I will continue in that capacity. I don't attend their meetings. I am on one of their policy advisory committees, so I will attend those, and then I would attend any meetings or have talks with them if there's anything pertaining to Minnetrista, of course. And then there's the Pioneer Sarah Creek. That's still open unless anybody wants to jump up and take that. And then we have the Gillespie Center liaison. I'm willing to do that again this year, unless anybody wants to jump up and help out. Otherwise, and then we have Westonka Community and Commerce, Mr. Christians. And then we have Spirit of the Lakes, and Pam, you did a fantastic job last year. And if you would do that again.
I will do that.
All right, that would be wonderful. And we have, concludes
that's the
council appointments. Are we on an agreement with that? I see heads nodding, so could I get a motion to approve the annual city council appointments and appointments, not the designations yet, right?
Sure.
Or
do them separately, or you can wait. Let's maybe pass through the designations and then.
Okay, we'll do the designations first then. Okay, depository.
That's pretty much
what it is.
Yeah, it's our investment brokers and bank or whatever.
So. Okay. Electronic funds transfer authority. Mr. Brony, Mr. Grimm, Ms. Bowl, and Ms. Motzko, because your
finance department and Mike, yep.
Okay. Fiscal agents, Ellers and Associates.
And Northland.
Yeah. Oh, Northland Securities, right. Minnesota Government Data Practices Responsibilities are Ms. Linquist, and when she's not here, Sandquist and Barone.
Yep.
I'm assuming they're the backup.
Deputy Clerk and myself.
And Minnesota Government Data Practices Compliance Official. Same, Ms. Linquist, the city clerk, along with Joni Sanquist and Mr. Barone as backup. Our official newspaper is the Laker. We really don't have any other official paper to.
Not really.
You know, we've looked at that before. So The Laker it is. Assistant weed inspector is Gary Peters.
Lucky you.
Yeah.
Somebody has to be it on staff. The mayor in every city is the weed inspector. Yeah. By statute.
By statute.
So you nominate an assistant weed inspector unless you want these out there helping you.
It might be.
So you get to
No, Gary. You're right. All right. Any changes? Otherwise, a motion then to approve the annual city council appointments and designation is in order.
I just have one question.
Sure.
On that rotating schedule, what's the best way to do that? Should we all just like submit these are dates good for us or
yeah.
months?
And then David, do you want to coordinate that?
Yeah.
Put a
and he'll put a calendar together then.
Okay.
Would that be doable, Mr. Abel? Submit it to Mr. Abel.
Okay.
And even, like I said, even if you don't know for sure if a month, but if you know you think it's okay, we can always exchange.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But then, yes, we kind of can plan for it a little bit. So submit those months to Mr. Abel, and then he'll put it on a calendar. Okay, good question. Any other questions? Otherwise, motion to approve?
So moved.
Okay, motion has been made, and is there a second?
Second it.
Okay, Mr. Christians has seconded that. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. So next, now, this is our accept part two of the Wellhead Protection Plan for submission to the Minnesota Department of Health.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. In your packet is a resolution that would authorize staff. First off, what the resolution would do would approve the plan that's been submitted to the council and then submit it to the Minnesota Department of Health for their review. We have a public hearing tonight and we had a few questions. Staff does recommend approval of the resolution and stand for any questions you might have on that.
The page of the resolution is?
Oh, I'm sorry.
61.
61?
Yes.
The motion is on page 60. Action.
Okay. So it would be resolution number 08-16, accepting part two of the City of Minnetrista Wellhead Protection Plan for submission to the Minnesota Department of Health. Is that correct, Mr. Hornby?
That's correct, yes.
All right.
So moved.
Okay, motion has been made. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, motion has been made by Mr. Vanderlinde and seconded by Ms. Thoele. Any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes, 5-0. Next, we have accept improvements and authorize final payment for Trillium Lane West Storm Sewer Improvement. Mr. Hornby.
Mayor and members of the council, this is on page
184.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we did skip a few pages there, didn't we?
120.
If you're counting. So in your packet there is a request from staff to authorize the final accepting of the improvements for the Trillium Lane stormwater improvements and authorizing final payment to Widmer Construction Company. The project originally as bid was around $50,000. The actual as constructed price or final construction amount was $30,250. This is one of those FEMA reimbursement projects, so when we quoted this out, we did not do a survey, so we went through and we estimated a lot of quantities and we did it in a manner that was conservative and walked the site. So there were a lot of things that could have been perhaps not perceived visually. So there's a lot of sediment down there and some, so we want to make some provisions to make sure that we could cover those items in a single contract. And so we did that, so that's why the project came in about $20,000 below the original contract amount.
You want to be sure we were covered
Correct.
So that we wouldn't have to go back yet another time to FEMA.
Correct.
Okay.
So the majority of this will be reimbursed through FEMA, and the final payment to company is $1,512.50, and staff recommends approval of the resolution stating, do you accept the work and the improvements, okay, and authorizing final payment.
All right.
So the $1,500 is the final payment, that's
correct.
It's like a punch list.
Everything else has
yeah.
been paid.
Everything's been done, the punch list is complete. There is one little phenomenon that we, I don't know, this is unique in this area, but apparently the raccoons are rolling back the sod because they're looking for insects or whatever underneath. I think that's kind of funny because when we first saw it, I thought it was the wind. And apparently the homeowner or one of our construction staff noticed that it was actually the raccoons doing it. So you come out there and there's it almost looked like a checkerboard with all the sod rolled back. So we had the contractor, we were going to have them stake it, but what ended up happening is our construction engineer, Matt, has stopped out every morning, and if it's been overturned, he's put it back. So.
That can't be good for the sod.
So, well, and with the rain and with the amount of rain we've gotten, the moisture,
okay,
I think it's settled down. So if there is any issue in the spring, it'll be a warranty item, and they could
okay.
replace it. So.
Okay.
It was just an odd phenomenon. I have not seen that happen in 27 some years doing this.
Okay, interesting. All right. Any other questions? Because we're glad to see that stormwater project being done. One more off of our list.
Yeah. If you've seen, if you haven't been down there,
yes,
maybe
go down
and look at it in the spring.
Yeah.
It actually
okay.
looks very nice. It came out very
yep.
well. I think the homeowners there are happy with it.
Okay.
I think it's going to be easier for Public Works to maintain.
Yeah, I stopped over there, quite a while ago after it was completed, so great.
I drove through there too, but it was a while since we had toured it, so I couldn't remember which. Do you have the house number, Mr. Hornby? Or
I can show you a map
on the cul-de-sac
yeah.
there. There.
Yeah. There's a catch basin in that northeast corner of the cul-de-sac.
Right.
And it's right goes right, right down the bank from there. So.
Yeah, like about 2 o'clock or so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay. Then do I have a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to accept the improvements and authorize final payment for Trillium Bay West Dorm Sewer Improvements.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Motion has been made by Mr. Christians and seconded by Mr. Vanderlinde to approve resolution number 0916. Further questions? All those in favor signify with aye.
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 All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Then we have approved plans and specifications and authorized advertisement for bids for wells number 3 and 5 rehabilitation project. We've talked about this before.
Yes, we
so
have.
So we kind of know it's coming.
So we went through the summer months with wells 3 and 5 and we're looking at more in the off season here doing the rehabilitation work. Initially, we wanted to do this work over the summer. Frankly, I'm glad we didn't, but we do want to get this work done. The reason we're actually going through the rehab process with wells 3 and 5 is that they will remain as a backup well, what backup wells for the water system. In the case where we have a peak day that we exceed our capacity of the new wells, and these wells would kick on as an emergency supply. One of the things we want to make sure of, though, is that when those wells kick on frequently, that we start looking at the more capacity for the water system. That's where there could be another well and water treatment plant in the southwest corner of the city.
Down by Hunter's Crest,
correct.
Yeah. You're saying down the road.
Right.
Yeah.
And from the population projection, the growth projections that we have now, it looks like that would the current system would carry us out to 2030, so it'll be down the road.
Okay.
Just a reminder for the council, this is why we're rehabbing these wells. So
now, if we use, they're going to be on kind of hiatus, so to speak, only if we need
correct.
As backup. And if you don't use them a lot, will that affect the water quality?
It'd be a lot better.
Okay.
Yes.
And then, and will they be connected to the water treatment plant?
No.
Okay, so.
Well, they're on the distribution system.
Okay.
So what ends up happening is if these wells kick on, they will put water directly into the system. But not treat it.
Okay, so that's why they're just a backup, just
correct.
An emergency. Let's say fire flow or something like that, I mean.
Correct.
Okay. All right,
yeah.
Okay.
And so these would also, at this time, you know, when we come through, you will be hearing from us again, requesting approving plans and specs for wells 6 and 7. That'll be, I think, here in the next month. And requesting advertisement for bids for those wells. With those new wells, we're not requesting additional appropriations from the DNR at this time, and that's because when those wells go in service, 3 and 4 become those backup wells.
Okay, but 6 and 7 are going to be new wells.
Those are new wells, yeah. And they will be your production wells for the water treatment plant, for the south water treatment plant.
Right, and so we don't have to borrow water from Mound or anybody else.
Not
for those.
Correct.
Okay,
yeah.
All right.
You know, when we do have opportunities to interconnect with our neighbors, we certainly look for those opportunities to continue to do that going forward, just as
okay.
emergency systems, both for us and for the neighboring cities.
So. Okay.
So there is a resolution in your packet. Staff does recommend adopting resolution 10-16, approving plans and specifications and authorizing the advertisement for bids for wells number 3 and 5 rehabilitation improvements. That's city project 03-15.
Okay.
One question I have for you, Paul. Is 3 and 5 currently not? No, they're not being used.
Yeah,
they are being
used.
Used.
Yeah, they're
no,
being used.
They are being used now. They are our supply now.
They're on supply now. So.
So when wells 6 and 7 come on board and the new treatment plants are on board, wells 3 and 5 will become backups.
Okay.
I believe 3 is South Saunders, right?
3
That's
is
5. That's
3
5.
Is on County Road 44.
That's 5. Okay.
And 5
and
is
3.
Six.
Okay.
I should mention in the memo in the middle paragraph under the background discussion that the statement in there says the south water system would be supplied by well number 4 during well 5 rehabilitation. Well, that was a typo. It's supposed to be well 3 rehabilitation. So when well 3 is down, well number 4 would be providing supply. And then when well 5 is down, we'll have to have water from the city of Mound. So,
okay. Yeah. Yeah, there's an interconnect, I think, right
correct.
There. So,
correct,
okay.
Because the central and the south systems are not.
How
connected.
Long will the rehabilitation take for each well?
Oh, I think overall this is going to be about a 3-month process.
I mean, for each well?
Yeah, but they can occur at the same time. I think we'll have, and I'll have to go back and look at the schedule specifically,
okay.
But they're going to have that same timeline.
Okay, are you notifying the residents that?
We will notify the residents that this will occurring. We'll also revisit Mound to make sure they're okay with this.
Okay.
We've talked to them already. So.
Okay. All right. Okay. Good. Any other questions?
So you're saying the water quality is not going to change while the rehabilitation is going on? I'm trying to figure out how that would get my
well, they're
going to
get
this.
Mound water, so it depends on.
Yeah, we won't have the same supply for the central system. And I'm not familiar with Mound's system, so I don't know if they have a similar water quality as well number 5 or not. On well number 4 and well number 3, the water quality should be about the same.
Okay, so the residents that are feeding off of these wells shouldn't really have an impact or notice.
No.
It shouldn't be, oh my gosh, my water's red.
Well, unfortunately, Mound's water is kind of as bad as ours right now. So.
Right.
Yeah.
I wouldn't think they're going to see.
Know, so there's no
yeah.
flare up of the residents seeing it.
Yeah, but I think nonetheless they should be notified so that they're aware that there should there be a difference or should they notice a difference, they know why we need to rehabilitate this well. We need to do it. So, and a few months after that, they should be getting clean water from the new treatment plants.
Well, what we can do too is notify them. We'll look at different ways of doing that. One good way to do that for those areas is do it through the water billing system, is to, you know, send them a notice with that.
Okay.
This is occurring, but we'll look at the timing on when those bills go out,
okay.
and when this work
okay.
would start. So
but
we'll
if
make
they
sure
pay
they get notified.
Electronically, they won't know. Right. Well, they still get the
they
bill.
Still get the bill.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
How do we financially deal with that with Mound?
They will charge us, I think, their rates for water. Yeah. They may put a surcharge on it, yes.
Okay.
That's kind of why I was asking time frame, because I'm thinking the longer it is, the more revenues that we're missing out on. So we want to do it as expediently as possible.
I would rather wait. You know, if it was up to, you know, well, we have, well, number 5 has an issue that we need to address, and I think we're better taking care of that one sooner than later.
Right, right.
That's, you know, well, three could probably wait, but if we're going to bid them out, we may as well do both at the same time.
Do them both, okay. All right. Good questions.
And these couldn't wait until wells six and seven were done. They need to be done. Three and five need to be rehabbed before six and seven come in.
I would recommend that. You're going to look at toward the end, you're going to be looking at this time next year and bringing these back. You know, we could do that if you wanted to do that, but I think there is some risk on well five.
Yep.
And then the thing we didn't want to do, one reason we waited a little bit through the summer, is we didn't want to tax mound system during the peak use water. So that's why we waited on that one. Mm-hmm. I would hate to do that again and have, you know, something happened next this coming summer. And well five goes out, we didn't rehab it. We're going to be taxing the mound system, and then you know we put them in a difficult position as well. Mm-hmm. So I'd rather not do that if we mm-hmm. can avoid it.
Okay. Does well three and four, do they normally operate together?
I mean, generally, we have one, especially in the lower peak, these lower peak season. One well generally. I think they alternate back and forth at this point.
No,
three is the primary, well four is the backup. Right. So well four is the one we put the screen on a few years ago.
Yeah.
So that's the one that will become the primary while three is under.
And once the water treatment plant comes online, both three and four are going to be backups.
Correct.
Yeah. Sure, correct.
So the new wells will both be 500 gallon per minute wells. Serving that.
Six and seven.
Yes.
Will be, okay.
And you'll see those coming in for the same request.
Okay.
Here in the next month, I believe.
And we already know where those are going to be drilled.
Yes.
Okay, and we have the land for those.
We have the land for those. We also built into the plans and specs for the water treatment plant to provide the controls for the and the pumps and everything with
okay.
that. So all of that next contract that comes that we'll be requesting on those two wells would just be to drill them.
Okay.
Drill and develop those wells.
Is there an issue with three right now? I mean, it's just the only thing I'm getting at is I don't want to dump a bunch of money in this well when within, you know, 11 months is going to be basically offline.
There aren't any maintenance records on it. So we don't know that it's been maintained prior to when Gary came on board as the public works supervisor. So not knowing that, you know, it's kind of like Russian roulette. Something could happen. When it is down, then you're out of water. So other than, you know, you have well four as a backup.
Right, we'd have to use well four as a backup. Yeah. Can well four handle summer?
No.
It can't, even with the sprinkler ban.
With a sprinkler ban, it might be able to, but...
I mean, you'd have to. I mean, it's an emergency situation. Yeah.
What about fire flow?
It'd be tough on the south end of town.
So which area is well number three and four?
Three and four are the southeast.
South.
Okay.
South and Hunters.
Hunters, Palmer Point. Yeah. Oh, southeast. I'm sorry.
Yeah,
so
south.
It's the south system. It's the south system. Everything from...
It's the south system.
Okay. Yeah, that's a huge area. So you don't think we could do three but wait on five? I mean,
I would not wait on five.
Okay. If it's a safety issue and fire flow issue, I don't know that you want to wait. I mean, that...
If we're going to do it, this is the time to do it.
Yeah.
Well, five does need to be rehabbed.
Okay.
There's a mechanical issue there. So we have to take care of that.
Because that one is... Five goes down, we're out.
Other
than hopefully the connector.
Yeah.
Do we have an interconnect for
with mound? We do, yes.
Yes,
well,
there's one right here, one.
Oh, five. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We do for five, but three and four we don't. So there's
correct.
No interconnect with three and four.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Paul, isn't this advertising for bids so we could see what we got on three and five and then even have more information?
Correct.
Yeah, I mean, I know. I think
this isn't awarding the project. This is authorizing the advertising.
Right, and you're having them bid separately.
They will be in the same bid package.
Because we don't know we need to do five. We know that,
mm-hmm.
and then three.
That's
is
what
the
I was
question.
Getting at. I guess. I mean, you could see how they came back, and then, I mean, can you break them out if you needed to.
We could make some provision in the contract that we could eliminate. Well, we do this anyway, that you can eliminate.
Okay, maybe that would be the way to go.
But there might be a, I'll look at the wording in the contract.
Okay.
I'll talk to our staff and then look at what
I mean, we may not want to do it anyway. It'll just give us a little extra information, but if it's a flow problem,
I understand the issue. I mean, these are wells that are going to be your future backup wells, and I understand the hesitation to go forward with them. Well number five, I think that one we have to do.
Right.
Well three, you know, there's been some discussion whether or not we want to even have well number four. So well three is going to be your backup through 2030. Best do maintenance, you know, my opinion is it's best to do maintenance on that, and if you're going to eliminate a well, you would abandon well number four.
Four, okay.
As a backup. So.
Okay.
But that's the one that's down in the real deep aquifer that if we do abandon, you can never drill back into it, right?
Is that in the Franconia? Or the,
yeah, they both are, actually.
Yeah.
In the Mount Simon Hinckley. Used to be called the Mount Simon Hinckley. And the new wells would not be, I don't know, Liz, if you remember what aquifer we're putting the new wells into. Yeah, 6 and 7, off of Kings Point Road.
Oh, aren't they the Mount Sinai? I think that's where.
Yeah, Mount Simon. I have to look and see which aquifer those are going into.
Yeah, because the deep one, they don't let you drill into it anymore, do they?
There is a community I worked with for a number of years that we did get a new well, mainly because of the entire system, water treatment and so forth was constructed based on treating that water. So if you wouldn't have gotten permission for that well in this particular case, the water you'd be treating would be from a different source, and it makes it more difficult to treat with the system you're using. So that's likely not the cause here. It would be an issue here, but ideally I think the plan would be is to keep three as the backup well. And when we're starting to look at appropriations are how much the DNR permits you to pump annually, you would take well number four offline and abandon that well. And so you would not be pumping that one. You'd use that appropriations from well four for 6 and 7. Because what's going to happen is if you ask to increase your appropriations, you're going to have to go through a permitting process to be able to do that. Or in this case, we can drop well number four off the system. And if we had to, we could do well number three, and that's going to have to happen when we put the third treatment plant in that third well. So that would be well three. Wells number three and four would be off the system. Well number five could be off the system too.
Okay. Okay. So we need a resolution to authorize the advertisement for bids for wells 3 and 5, basically for proposals. So is there a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion has been made by Ms. Mortenson and seconded by Mr. Vanderlinde to approve resolution number 10-16. Further questions, comments? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. And our last order of business before Mr. Christians leaves is approving a purchase of a Caterpillar Model 420F2, a backhoe loader.
This is Mr. Peters.
Madam Mayor, City Council, we're looking at replacing a 1997 Ford New Holland backhoe that we have right now. It's in need of a lot of repair work right now. It does meet everything that was set forth in the vehicle equipment acquisition and use and replacement policy that was adopted in September of 2013 as far as age and condition. We did demo two different types. We were going to do three, but on recommendation of the staff, one was not chosen. It was really a toss-up between the Caterpillar that we did and the John Deere. Both excellent pieces of equipment. The reason that the Caterpillar was chosen was just for price.
Okay, any questions? Mr. Vanderlinde, you're kind of the backhoe man?
I guess just a couple. I mean, I don't want to pick it apart. One thing that I noticed, and it's little things like front fenders. I mean, those things are usually the first thing that you have a problem with falling off. That kind of
the
stuff.
Only reason we have them on there is because we do road travel it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It does cut down a lot of spray.
Yeah. And the forks. Do we have forks for our front end loader?
No, we do not. We do not have a set of forks at all right now. So when you're in the yard moving culverts and stuff, it is very tough to do. So
the skids don't.
The skid, we have one set of forks for the skids, but they're the smallest, they're short stock. Yeah. So when we're unloading, I mean, it would come in handy just for doing that, especially on the job site, we don't have the skid there.
Right.
We can have it there.
And I guess your opinion is the extended warranty worth it?
We believe it is. Just due to the fact that we do not have a certified mechanic, and with the hours that we put on, I definitely think it's going to be worth what we can get into it.
Okay.
It's a bumper to bumper type warranty, and for the price. Talking to Mike Pollock, who's done repairs for years, he definitely, definitely recommended it, and I trust him. So
yeah, it's definitely a different ballpark nowadays. If you don't have your computer hookups,
yeah,
you don't work.
Yeah, and without having any of the equipment or any of the like you say, the diagnostic tools that
right.
it's so hard to do here. So
yeah. Okay, thank you.
I just have one. The 1997 backhoe. You said it's 1997.
Yep.
Mechanically, I mean, is there any big issues or problems with it?
The complete back end needs to be redone, all new pin seals.
Maybe we don't want to say that because if you want to sell it, I'm just kidding.
Unless they're watching me.
Well, the reason, okay, let me,
trade
let me,
in value.
Let me just take it a step further.
Bleep that out. Temporary disconnect.
They already know what's wrong.
Yeah, can I go a different direction? You're going to get rid of it.
Correct.
And when you get rid of it, it's going to go to some auction house or someplace.
Well, we'll trade it to the dealers.
They traded it.
The
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Don't disclose
we
more
did,
than
we
have
did,
to.
We did do some research on it and looked online to see what they would bring. And talking to Brian, we don't know if the extra few thousand dollars that we could get for is worth the time and effort to put it to an auction. Okay.
The only reason I'm bringing that up is I know somebody that's interested in one. That's all. So.
It's only driven to church on Sundays by a little old lady.
Well, that's what I was thinking. See, that's what I was thinking.
Make him a heck of a deal.
Yeah. Yeah. I know somebody that would be interested in it, but that's fine. I just was curious to know what mechanically it sounds.
Are we charged sales tax on this equipment?
I believe on that we are. The only thing we are not charged sales tax, Brian, is on plow equipment if it's used for 100% plowing.
Yeah, it's sort of a weird deal. We got exemptions on most things. This is one of the few things that the state hasn't exempted yet. Is
really?
Heavy equipment that's not designated totally for snow plowing. So
snow
sort
plowing.
Of a...
Right.
It helps a little bit when you trade it in. It brings your gross down.
Right.
Yeah.
Sales tax.
Right. Eliminate that. So.
Okay. Well, we'll have an opportunity to maybe present that idea to eliminate the sales tax. I believe it's next meeting. Mr.
Yeah.
Hartos, our representative, will be here. So maybe that's something we could ask him to do. But they've looked at it in the past, but it's not gone anywhere. But anyway, all right. So moving this along, since Mr. Christians has to leave, we have a purchase of the Caterpillar. Is there a motion to approve that purchase?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, Mr. Vanderlinde made the motion and it was seconded by Ms. Thoele to approve the purchase of the Caterpillar Model 420F2 backhoe loader. Further questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. And then real quick, one of the things I added is just when we want to have a discussion on RFPs for services. And I said we'd just have a quick discussion as to when staff should bring that back. I'm going to say because of the agendas that we have for the next couple of meetings, and then I believe Ms. Thoele, you're going to be absent for that
second
meeting
in
February. If we could bring that back maybe in March, the first or second meeting in March. Is everybody going to be here? It'd be nice to have everybody here.
Yes, but I may be gone that same week that Patricia's gone in February. Is that a problem?
It might be.
Right.
Well,
you're talking about the 16th?
Yes.
I think there's three, so we're going to move that RFP discussion maybe to our, should we do the second meeting? What staff, do you have a preference?
Let's do the second meeting.
Second meeting in March? Okay. So we'll bring that back, the second meeting in March.
And the meeting, Councilmember Mortenson, the meeting I'm going to miss is, it's Tuesday, February 16th, and it's a Tuesday because that Monday is President's Day.
Okay, and you're going to miss that as well. So we'll might be down to three. We'll see what we have on the agenda. If it's not a heavy agenda, maybe we'll just cancel the meeting. We'll see what we have. Otherwise.
You're talking about the February.
February, right. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Martin Luther King in January.
I'm going to be gone January.
Okay. So you're going to be gone for the second meeting in January?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Well, then we'll definitely want to move it to March. All right. Okay. With that, we move on to staff reports. We'll start with our city administrator, Mr. Barone.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Just a couple of items, as everybody has already known since it's been discussed a couple of times. Our next meeting isn't until Tuesday, January 19th, because of the President's Day holiday. And then also, as the Mayor just alluded to, Representative Hertas did contacted me late last week and is interested in coming to our January 19th meeting that night. I'm going to, just so to give the council a heads up, I am going to put him under special presentations, but he will not be here right at 7 o'clock. We will just, when he does arrive, he said roughly 7:45 or so, because apparently Representative Hertas is going to visit a number of his communities ahead of the session that begins in March, and so he has another city already that night at 7. When he's done, he'll rush over here and meet with us and just give a short presentation on what he thinks the legislative session is going to be like this year. So we've got him coming roughly 7:45, but like I said, I'll just put him on the agenda for the special meeting. If we're in the middle of a business item, we'll finish it, go to Mr. Hertas, and then go back to our business items. So,
okay.
And that's all I have.
That's all you have. And City Engineer, Mr. Hornby.
I have a couple of items to bring the council up to date on. There is a major project plan for County Road 44. This involves the extension of a Met Council force main along County Road 44. Basically from Mound across 110 and just north of Highway 7. So we'll cut into the park just north of Highway 7 on the east side. There is just one introductory meeting. I was unable to attend that. I actually found out about an hour before the meeting took place, so that was kind of difficult to get out to. But they will include me in future meetings. But the county is also looking at potentially reconstructing County Road 44 at that same time. So there would be some closures, detours, that kind of thing anticipated for that project. Mm-hmm. I don't have the exact, we're just starting preliminary design, so we're probably at least a year out before construction, possibly two.
Possibly two,
so I don't have that schedule yet. So.
Okay. Then a question, Jennings Cove Pond, when do you anticipate bringing that back for more consideration? I hate to put you on the spot, but I do know Mr. Hosmer has been waiting.
I'd like to bring that back to the council in February.
Okay. So would it be the first meeting in February since we're...
I think so.
Okay.
With the holidays, the end of the year was hard. I think the watershed district had a lot of permits, and even trying to get a return phone call was difficult.
Yeah.
So we did contact them and have some discussion about some of the alternatives, but I think it's best that I sit down face to face with them, meet with them,
right,
and go through it, because I just want to make sure we don't get a design authorized and gone through the expense of designing it and have a permit rejected.
Yeah.
So I anticipate I'd bring the amended report back to the council at first meeting in February.
Okay. Okay. Anything else?
I hate to interrupt. There's something I'd like to ask a couple questions before Bob leaves, because he's kind of part of this deal. A couple things from last meeting. there was some talk, and you, Mayor, you brought up something about a CIP project.
Mm-hmm.
And
yep.
Can you?
A CIP project is a capital improvement project that includes roads or anything. Highland Road was an improvement project that was awarded, I believe it was in 2011 or 12?
12. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So I don't, can you explain why you brought it up?
Well, I think it was, the reason I brought it up was because I was accused of making a promise, which is not correct, but and not keeping it. And I said, well, wait a second, how come you're coming now telling me after 4 years of not being on the council, and the previous council for 4 years didn't maintain the tax rate, and all of a sudden I'm supposed to maintain the tax rate? And I've kind of been handed this thing, and I'm supposed to now maintain the tax rate. And I said, you know, previous councils, some of the people that were here 4 years ago, made promises in their campaigns that they would not do any capital improvement projects without a referendum. And then in 2011 or 2012, shortly after they were elected, they approved the Highland Road project. I don't disagree with that project. It needed to be done. But you can't put everything up for a referendum. And sometimes, you know, I mean, it's, you know, so, and all I'm saying is, one, I never promised that the 27% tax rate would go into perpetuity. The city said, according to all of the information that we have and the statistics that we currently are working with, it looks like we should be able to looks like we're projecting the tax rate to remain somewhere in the 27 percentile. When I came on board, I believe last year it was in the 29 percentile. And then to say to me, well, now you, one person on the council, it's my responsibility to maintain it at 27%, you know, it's just kind of ludicrous. So that's all. That's what I was referring to. Yeah. Any other questions or comments you care to make?
Well, it was just, you know, there was nobody on that was on the previous council. There was no promise of anything like
but
that.
What
I'm not talking that. I'm just saying if the Highland Road project was, if people didn't want it, they could have came and done a reverse referendum on it if they'd have wanted to, and nobody did.
And if people didn't want the tax, the levy that we approved, they could have come and said something, and we had one person here.
Yeah, so
it's interesting, too, because
so
tax
that's why I don't understand why that was, why that was brought up. I mean, it was, if somebody didn't want it, they could have came and done with a petition. So, but anyway, but the only other question I have is, this is more of kind of a personal or ethical question is, what happened at that meeting? I think calling other council members names I don't think is appropriate for a council. I mean, calling people weasels because they don't vote the same way you do.
I didn't call anybody a weasel. I didn't call anybody a weasel.
I think you did.
No, I didn't. You can look at I never called anybody a weasel. No.
You said we weaseled out.
Yeah, I said I think that's kind of weaseling out of it.
Do you think that's appropriate behavior for a council?
I think it's an appropriate behavior for every council member to weigh in on what they think about the budget. And we had discussed that at length. And yet, to date, we don't have some of the council members weighing in on what they wanted for the budget. And Mr. Christians, and this is referring to Mr. Christians, he said he's okay with a 2% increase. But when asked, come on, where do you want to make the cuts then? Nothing was forthcoming. In addition to that, he said, well, promises were made, so we need to maintain the promise of 27% tax rate. And that's when I said, wait a second, in the past 4 years, nothing was talked about in terms of maintaining that promise. Nothing ever was said by either a council member or Mr. Notch and the people that supported getting you elected. Nothing was ever said by them that you needed to maintain the tax rate. Now, all of a sudden, we're here, and now all of a sudden, oh, it's very important to maintain the tax rate. And because you said a promise was made, and I said, wait a second, that's kind of weaseling out of it, because you need to make a stand. You need to say, hey, this is what I want. If you want a 2% increase, then tell the council, tell the public, tell staff what in this budget you want to have removed. But that was never done.
That's fine, but like I say, I don't think it's appropriate to say that somebody.
I don't think it's appropriate in some of the things that are, that you say either. But I don't sit here and call.
I've never insulted anybody, have I?
Oh yes, you have. Yes, you have. You have.
Like when?
Well, I'm not going to get into it with you right now, Mark. But
if you're accusing me of something, then tell me what I'm talking about.
I will talk to you off camera about it because I don't think this is appropriate.
Question anybody's way they voted.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that you have offended people and you've accused me of different things at times. So to sit here and say, you've never accused me, yeah, you have. And I'm not going to get.
I don't think I have.
I know you don't think you have, but you have, and I can tell you which meeting it was at.
I've never called you that you're weaseling out of something. I think we're better than that. Our residents deserve better than that.
Mr. Christians, you would care to leave? I see you tapping your timer.
I'm really sorry.
Go ahead. Feel free. Yeah, I understand. I understand. Mm-hmm. Okay. With that, we'll move on to public safety. Is there anything?
Madam Mayor, members of the council, I just have two quick updates. They have to do with two roadway locations within our city, and I'll credit Mr. Hornby on this because he actually contacted the county on the city's behalf and then forwarded that information to me. So as you recall, back in the summer of 2014, we had some heavy rains which resulted in mudslides along County Road 44. Since that time, there's been a number of questions about whether or not the county would be willing to put up a guardrail along that stretch. Some of the small trees did slide. However, they probably weren't very sufficient for holding vehicles up as they were. However, we've brought that concern forward to the county, and as Mr. Hornby mentioned earlier, they're looking at they're certainly looking at putting in a guardrail. They're not committing to that, but they're going to review that as part of the ongoing process when they look at rebuilding that after the force mains and other utilities and things that are going to go in there go in. So it's still on the list. And we don't have a yes or no, but they've committed to at least reviewing that as part of that project. The second location is the intersection of County Road 15 and 92. As you're aware, we've had a number of accidents there over the years, generally related to somebody just not stopping. It's a four-way stop, all directions. And so what the county did is they added additional signage. Generally, you get a stop sign on the right side. They've added one on both the left and right side. They've increased the size of the signs, and then they've added some reflective material above the sign. So it's definitely a much more visible signage from all directions. Okay. At that location. So
hey, Paul.
Yes.
I live in that area, and people have noticed the new signage and all of that. So thank you.
Good. That's good to hear. Thank you, Mr. Hornby, for contacting the county. They certainly, the County Road 15 and 92 intersection, they took care of that really quickly. I know we requested flashing lights. They chose to do this. They felt it was a better fit, less maintenance, more visibility. So we'll see how this works, and hopefully that will keep the crashes to a minimum or eliminate them.
Chief Falls or Mr. Hornby, do either of you know if Hennepin County's plans are to widen County Road 44 or just upgrade it? Or
I don't have that information yet.
Okay.
So they just had a preliminary meeting, so I will get into those design details, I think, as we move forward with that.
Okay. Well, and as a person that uses that road frequently, I would be highly in favor of those guardrails since the storm and the washout.
Keep us posted. Yeah. Okay. Anything else from staff? All right. Then quickly, are we having a personnel committee meeting Wednesday?
We're still working on those.
Okay.
Arrangements.
All right. And then Planning Commission, I'll take January. In February, we have our next Police Communications Committee meeting. And then also, you all probably got this Mailer from the LMCC. It's January 22nd and 23rd. It's What Makes Your City Lovable? And during this interactive two-day workshop, you'll understand how we fall in love with our cities and the impact that, et cetera, et cetera. So think about it. This is trying to engage citizens and trying to make citizens excited about the city we live in. And that's really, I know we've seen, we've talked a little bit about that. That would be a really good workshop for us. So I'm planning on attending. Hopefully some of the other council members will be able to as well. We have the Northwest League will be meeting again next week, and I did attend a policy committee meeting for the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District in December, and our next one will be in February. And I do not believe, to the best of my knowledge, that there was a Pioneer Sarah Creek Watershed Commission meeting in December. And then the next Fire Advisory Mound Fire Advisory Board meeting will be January 23rd. Third, is it? I believe. 23rd or 27th. It's towards the end of the month, and I'll be attending that. That's all I have in a nutshell. Anything?
Let's see. As I mentioned earlier, it may have been during the work session, I was invited by the president of the North Saunders Lake Home Owners Association, Mr. Beerbaum, to attend their annual meeting on Sunday, January 31st. So I will be sitting in on that and look forward to meeting or seeing some of those individuals, and then we'll mention to them about the opportunity on the Parks Commission as well.
Mr. Vanderlinde.
I have nothing.
Okay, Ms. Mortenson.
Let's see, I attended the Planning Committee meeting, the special one, on December 14th, and it was interesting. It was taken to a vote, and I think at this point we're waiting for an appeal to see if appeal is brought forward.
Or not.
And so after that, we will probably be seeing it here at the council.
If they appeal it, yeah.
If they appeal it.
Okay.
And Spirit of the Lake meeting is starting next week.
Wow.
Woo! So I will be attending that, and you'll be hearing more then.
Great. Anything else? All right. Then we can be adjourned.
Okay. I make a motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor signify with aye.
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 All those opposed, motion passes. Thank you very much.
Well, this one is still through your email. You might jump in that email.
I deleted the email.